It's time for Around the Nest as we J-Talk our way around the Toronto Blue Jays minor league organization, talking from AAA all the way down to rookie ball with all the latest highlights and what's going on with the Jays prospects and more with the radio voices of the Toronto Blue Jays minor league organization. I'm Jesse Goldberg-Strassler of the Lansing Lugnuts. You can find us not just online, but also check in with YouTube. We're now posting all of the audio along with a way for you to link in and immediately jump to whichever broadcaster you would like to hear, whichever is going on with all of those teams in question. There's a brand new YouTube channel up, and it's all available on SoundCloud and iTunes as well. Well, we begin this week with a special guest, joined by Chris King of Baseball Prospectus. One level that we've never had the opportunity to speak about is the Gulf Coast League. Chris, how are you?
Very well, Jesse. How are you doing?
Doing well. Well, we can now talk the GCL, and we can specifically talk about players like, for example, the Toronto Blue Jays first-rounder, Max Pentecost. You've had the opportunity to see him, so what do you think?
Well, first game, you could tell he was a little rusty after his layoff. He had a little bit of a timing issue with the plate, but as you guys, I'm sure, saw, game two was a little five-for-five action, so seemed to put those timing issues aside rather quickly. Which, make adjustments like that at pro ball is a nice little glimpse into the future.
The joke around the Lansing Lugnuts coaching staff was immediate Gulf Coast League All-Star. What adjustments do you look for with a youngster who's just come in? It's been a long college season, and they had a nice postseason journey. Is it about timing? Is it about getting used to some things? What are you looking for a young player in trying to get used to the new league and used to professional baseball?
For me, I just like to see, like you mentioned, good timing, how he can pitch recognition skills, you know, see a little bit better breaking stuff now, and just how he reacts to that and whether he can barrel the ball up, which he definitely showed the ability to do.
How does he look defensively?
Defensively, you know, there's definitely some work there to do. Going into the draft, you know, I wasn't that familiar with him. I watched him play in the regionals up in Tallahassee, and, you know, he's graded out as about as an average catcher, and that's pretty much what you see. Definitely some work to do in his footwork and his release on throws, but, you know, the bat's going to play, so he'll learn to live with the defensive lapses at times, but it's nothing crazy bad. You know, he's going to be more than serviceable behind the plate.
From one draft pick to another, that's what you look for from an offensive player. Sean Reid-Foley has drawn an awful lot of attention in the second-round draft pick. What do you look for in young pitchers in their first excursion into pro ball?
Pitchers, I just like to see them attack hitters, see what kind of mental side they bring to the game. Definitely strike-throwing ability and whether he can locate his secondary stuff as well. And Sean is another kid I kept close tabs on as an amateur. He was a Florida State commit, which is, you know, I lived in Tallahassee for college, so kind of sad he didn't go there, but it was obviously no surprise that he didn't. Sean, I didn't see his debut. Heard it was a little rough. He was, you know, a little erratic, a little wild, but from what I saw the other night, he was pumping strikes with three different pitches. He's throwing his fastball like 91 to 95 with really good movement on it. Shows a good feel for his changeup, and the slider was missing bats. So definitely a nice first impression for me.
Speaking with Chris King of Baseball Prospectus, and you can find him on Twitter at @StatsKing. That same game that Reid-Foley pitched, you also got to see Roberto Osuna getting the start and pitching the first inning. And I'm looking at your tweet right now. Osuna, you said, looked great. Threw about 15 pitches, sitting easily at 95 to 97. I guess what more can Jays fans want to hear?
Exactly. I mean, like you said, it was a real short outing. They're going to probably play it pretty cautiously with him. No need to get too aggressive. But, yeah, you couldn't ask for much more. He came in pumping strikes. And the thing that really stood out to me was just the low effort. Like, if you were sitting there and you didn't have a gun, I mean, obviously he's popping the mitt and you can tell, but just there's it's such free and easy velocity. It's really really encouraging to see that, especially in his first start coming off of surgery.
Had you seen Osuna before this appearance?
Very brief looks. You know, I'd see him throw a couple side sessions during spring training a couple years ago, but nothing live game action like that, no.
All right, so you'd heard about him, and yet I guess it's only 15 pitches, so it's tough to tell. And yet, 95 to 97, free and easy. And so just,
yeah.
I guess, check him off the list, right? Back from Tommy John.
Exactly. Now, like a lot of guys coming back from surgery, the velo might not be there right off the bat. They might struggle a little bit with their command and feel and, you know, with their mechanic-wise, might have some trouble repeating their deliveries. But Roberto is, I mean, you know, just a strike-throwing machine. Like, it was only 15 pitches, but I'm off the top of my head, I don't even recall maybe three balls, maybe, if that.
Man.
And you throw in the 95-97 factor, and, you know, can't ask for much more.
I can imagine. Speaking with Chris King, now we're partnered up with Bluebird Banter this year via SB Nation for Around the Nest, and so we love taking questions from commenters. And so a question about Max Pentecost, to go back briefly. Pentecost's 5-for-5, were all five hits hard, or did the pitchers make mistakes? Did he hit any difficult pitches?
I know his first hit was an infield single. Kind of rolled over and hit a little slow roller, but, you know, Max is a – he can run for a catcher. And he's definitely an above-average runner right now at this stage. So that was the only ball that was not hit hard. The rest of them, he hit a hard ground ball opposite field for a single. He ripped a line drive single into left. And then the two doubles, second double, I believe, he absolutely smoked that thing on a straight line right off the wall in left field.
We had another question from a Bluebird Banter commenter noting that you had a quick tweet about Angel Perdomo. We'll probably speak about him much more in subsequent weeks, but he's been piling up the strikeouts so far. What have you seen from Perdomo?
Perdomo is a very intriguing arm. First couple looks, he's a little erratic. He's missing his spots, you know, pretty frequently. And then the other day he came in and, I mean, he lasted four innings, which in the GCL is like going six or seven in a regular league. And, I mean, easy velocity coming from the left side. Nice, very nice arm action and arm speed. And was able to control the zone for his entire outing, something I hadn't seen before, so it was definitely nice to finally see him take a step forward.
And lastly, I just had a tweet sent in wondering your opinion on Lane Thomas. We never know what comments we're going to get. What do you think about Lane Thomas?
Thomas has a lot of skills, man. He's been primarily batting leadoff and shows good bat-to-ball skills. He uses the whole field, willing to go the opposite way. Plays, they've been mixing him up. He actually made his first start the other day at third base after primarily playing the outfield. Didn't look that comfortable over there, but that is to be expected, I suppose. But, yeah, definitely a kid that be keeping some tabs on.
And finally, how about a brief preview before we get to our question of the week? I'm joined by Chris King of Baseball Prospectus. Before we get into more depth down the road about some upcoming future prospects, is there any one name or two names that you would like to drop about a guy who has surprised you in the GCL?
I wouldn't say surprised, but Yeltsin Godino has been very fun to watch so far. You know, he's a young kid. He's either 17 or I'm not sure if he's 18 yet. But one of the smoothest gloves you'll see at shortstop for that age and in this league. He's got very good range to both sides. He's got a very good, accurate arm. Obviously, a lot of work to do, you know, building up that body. He's a pretty small frame, but really like what I'm seeing out of him.
Excellent. Yeltsin Godino, will store it away. Our question of the week. And firstly, for Chris King, before we get into the other broadcasters about the system, for Chris from Baseball Prospectus is simply with what's going on with Clayton Kershaw. And I know his scoreless streak came to an end yesterday, but with how locked in he was, for you personally and the ballplayers that you've seen, what's the most locked in you can remember a player making baseball look easy?
Oh, wow. The most ever. I would have to say probably, I mean, a lot of people might not like this, but I'd have to say Barry Bonds. And he had his, you know, monster 73. I mean, it doesn't get any more locked in than that for me.
I don't think that's hard to disagree with. That makes sense
yeah,
to me.
I mean, yeah. Whether you love Bonds or hate Bonds, you know, that was just amazing what he did.
Chris, thank you very much for joining us this week on Around the Nest, and look forward to hearing from you in the future. It's great to get a perspective on the GCL.
Oh, thanks for having me, man. I look forward to coming back.
Beautiful. From Chris King of Baseball Prospectus, let us now go up the ladder. I believe Kevin Fitzgerald joins us from the Bluefield Blue Jays. Kevin, how are you?
Hey, Jesse. How's everything going?
Everything's going well. So we've heard from Chris at the Gulf Coast League level. Now let's hear about Bluefield, where your Blue Jays are sizzling. What made the change? Who's been spearheading how well that the Blue Jays have been playing?
Yeah, you know what? You're kind of making it tough on me because from 1-9 in the order, this is probably the most balanced this team has looked all season long. It, you know, it's not just one player that's led to five straight wins and you know, dating back to about a week and a half ago, these guys have won 7 of their last 9. It's really about the balance in the order right now. You're looking at, you know, a possibility of 2 consecutive sweeps for the Blue Jays if they defeat the Bristol Pirates tonight. And if you look at the last handful of games, you know, 1-9, almost every night, almost every batter is getting on base. I think there's only been a couple games during this 5-game stretch where you've had multiple guys in the order not reach base, and really has been, you know, 7, 8, 9 guys have been getting on. 1-3 in the order is racking up the hits. It really has been everybody. And I was talking about that with our manager, Dennis Holmberg, today about the balance. And he says, you know, right now this is the best groove his team has been in. And, you know, it's because they're getting contributions from guys that maybe you wouldn't have expected to fill up the power numbers or get on base game after game. And he said, look, I mean, we have a stud, and his name is Rowdy Tellez. And you guys know that name by now. He's a solid power hitter. He can drive in runs. And you know what? He struggled a bit. He said, you know, look, if we were relying solely on Rowdy, then we wouldn't be in the position where we are. But we have guys like a Rolando Segovia, second baseman from Venezuela, who over the course of the last 5 nights is racking up doubles, hitting home runs, driving in runs. And remember, this guy he's about 5'10", and he can fly around the base pass, but he's racking up the power numbers. Lydell Mosby, you guys know all-star Lloyd Mosby from back in the 80s. His son is he's just swinging a hot bat. Hit his first home run a few days ago, starting to drive in runs, hitting the ball with power. You have plenty of guys that are stepping up and making contributions that were not early on in the season, and that's to be expected. You're just getting started. The season is underway. So the theme of this, the sizzling stretch, like you mentioned, has been the in the order and getting contributions from everybody. I mean, 1-9 in the order. Everyone's getting on. Everyone's moving runners over. Everyone's driving runners in. It really hasn't been one particular player. It's been everybody, and that's been the beauty of it.
How fun, then, is the atmosphere around the team?
It's, you know, it's certainly the best atmosphere and probably the, you know, the most positivity that you've seen in the clubhouse and around the team. Certainly to this point in the season, it really has been fun. And these guys, you know, you can start to see it, and I think, you know, you're starting to notice it the last couple of games, really probably over the last week or so. These guys are starting to gel. They really are. And you know, it's funny because we got a lot of guys from all over the place, from all over the country, from Venezuela, from Dominican Republic, and you can see it now. It's just everybody's starting to get on the same page, comfortable with each other. You have some guys, Dennis brought this up, you have a couple players that have been drafted out of high school over the last couple of years and have been in the minor league circuit for a couple of years. Y'all mentioned guys like Dan Jansen, Matt Morrell, Ryan Barucki. These guys have been through this grind before, and you can just see it. You can see these guys starting to show some of the 2014 draft picks the way, starting to get on the same page. You can tell that the guys that have been through this grind before, the new guys are starting to catch on to that. What's expected? What do you need to do on a day-to-day basis? How do you get into that routine? I was talking about that with our pitching coach, Antonio Castro, a few days ago, is that sooner or later, these pitchers, they're 17, 18, 19 years old, they're going to develop their own routine. Sometimes, you know, I'll use that as an example, sometimes they come to this level and they come from the Dominican Summer League or the Gulf Coast League, and they have not, they don't have a routine yet. You know, you wake up and then you do your routine, you get to the ballpark, and you can start to see some of these guys creating one. And that's really, that's taking that next step. And I think that's been the biggest thing. We always say in baseball, routine, routine, routine. But, man, it's you can see the results paying off now from these guys just learning it, creating their own. And, again, the biggest thing to me is that the guys that have been in this minor league level for a year or two, you can see them just – you can see the other guys picking up on what they need to do in their first year in minor league baseball. And I think that's been a reason for a lot of the success.
We are joined by Kevin Fitzgerald of the Bluefield Blue Jays. We began by talking about offense, and then I look back to yesterday and I see, yeah, Bluefield won 4-0. It was Josh Almonte homering for the second time this year. No. The story is pitching. The story is it Daniel Lietz? Is that how Lietz pronounces his last name?
Yes. And he is, he's fresh off of a quick visit to Vancouver. He was up in low A ball in the Northwest League. About a week ago, pitched in 7 innings there, flawless baseball, and he comes down here. He throws 4 innings a few nights ago, doesn't give up a run. He starts tonight, the previous night against Bristol, goes 5 innings, strikes out 4, doesn't give up a run, and picks up the win yesterday. It really has been the pitching, Jesse. And, you know, you look at this, the Blue Jays have won 7 of their last 9. Over their last 8 games, the total ERA for the team is a scorching 1.67 ERA, not just bullpen, not just starters, the entire pitching staff over the last 8 games, the ERA is almost as low as 1.50. So the pitchers have gotten into a groove. And you know what, I go back to that routine thing because we're now starting to settle into what the rotation is probably, we've hammered out what the rotation is probably going to look like the rest of the season with guys like Dan Lietz. Jesus Tinoco went 4 scoreless innings yesterday. He's a hard-throwing right-hander from Venezuela. The guy can probably touch 95, 96 with his fastball. These guys, they're starting to get into that 5-day routine, that 5-day rhythm, and the pitching staff, the starters have really been chiseled out. But Lietz he's just a fun pitcher to watch because he's aggressive. He's quick on the mound. You got to love a left-hander who just gets out there and just grinds through batters. And he challenges hitters. He really does. And that's been the theme of the last few days because, Lietz was yesterday. Miguel Burgos, who's a great left-hander from Venezuela, he's thrown 8 consecutive scoreless innings in back-to-back starts. These guys are not big guys. You know, Dan Lietz, Miguel Burgos, they're not 6'3", 225 pounds. I mean, they are your average-sized lefties, but they have got great location, and they come at you. They challenge you. They're going to put the fastball in the inside corner of the plate, and they're going to make you hit it. So I think that's been the big key for the success on the mound, especially the last 3 games, 4 games or so, is that Bluefield pitchers, they have challenged hitters, and they've come out on top. That's been the biggest key, and they have looked really, really sharp, the entire pitching staff. You know, there's been you'll see Evan Smith on the mound tonight. You know, he's going to make his first start for the Blue Jays after just getting here just about a week ago. So it's been if you are a fan of good pitching and good baseball and aggressive throwing, Bluefield is the place for you right now because it's been solid pitching.
This is Kevin Fitzgerald of the Bluefield Blue Jays, who have won 5 consecutive games. Their record is now 11-10, and they're 9-3 at home. And I guess the Bowen Field in its 75th anniversary, and that crowd is getting used to seeing some winning, powerful baseball.
Yeah, I think that's starting to be the trend. You know, these 5 straight wins, they've all been at home, so it's been nice for the crowds here to get a sense of, this team picking up the wins. Early on in the season, they had back-to-back 3-game home sets and lost both of those series, so now they're starting to win at home, and you know what? The fans will be happy tonight because win, lose, or draw tonight, they'll have a fireworks display. That always gets everybody going here at Bowen Field. So that'll be the extra treat tonight, whether they win or lose. But yeah, you're back. That's the key. I mean, you come home for 6 games. And the Blue Jays have a chance to win all six of them if they win tonight against Bristol before heading on the road to take on the Princeton Rays. So that's where, you know, if you can win in bunches, if you can win in front of your home crowd, and like you said, the 9-3 record, you know, they figured out the way of this ballpark. They figured out the ins and outs of it, and the wins are starting to pile up. So you're right. The fans are getting, so they're getting a show later. They've got plenty of treats over these last 6 days.
Before we turn our attention up the ladder in Vancouver, our question of the week for Kevin Fitzgerald, what is the most locked in you've ever seen a player?
Yeah, this was an interesting one that I saw you brought up, and it got me thinking a little bit. I got to bring up I used to work and cover baseball up. There's a collegiate summer league on Cape Cod, the Cape Cod Baseball League. Excuse me, and you know, that's where some of the best collegiate players across the country go to play their summer ball. It's a wood bat league. You know, for plenty of people, you know, are recognized that lead. And there was a player up there. His name is Trevor Gott, and I believe he is still in the Padres organization. He was just a hard throwing right hander. Played at the University of Kentucky, and there was an inning. You know, he was a closer. He actually set the Cape League record for saves in his first summer up on the Cape. He was there for two consecutive years. He saved 12 games in 1 year. He set the record for that season. And this was maybe the second or third game, and it was the 2012 season. I was up there a couple summers ago. This guy stepped out on the mound. He throws 9 pitches, 9 fastballs, 9 consecutive strikes, and he strikes out the side to record a save. I had never seen anything like that before. He was just in a complete zone, and he said his catcher and he just kept throwing down ones. You know, he didn't even think about a curveball or a changeup or anything, but I'd never seen that. 9 straight pitches, they were all fastballs, they were all probably close to 95, and he was getting guys swinging. Guys were looking at these pitches right over the zone, so that was probably the most locked in I had ever seen a pitcher in one performance. 9 pitches, 3 outs, and they're all fastballs. That was, certainly was a sight.
Man. Kevin, thank you very much for joining us this week. Best of luck to your Bluefield Blue Jays. I'll check in again with you next Friday.
All right. Take care, Jesse. Thanks again. Have a good one.
Absolutely. And from Kevin Fitzgerald, let us mosey our way up the ladder and bring in Lucas Scott with the Vancouver Canadiens. Lucas, how are you?
I'm doing great. Jesse, how are you doing today?
Doing terrific. Let's talk about a player, a shortstop, an infielder who's caught some notice, Tim Locastro. What is he delivering to Vancouver?
Yeah, well, you'd ask me really to find a guy that maybe you don't see pop up on the box score every single night or hasn't been getting a ton of publicity among some of the other guys that we've, you know, obviously there's been a lot of hype around Barreto and the start he had of the season, and Ryan McBroom coming in here and hitting those home runs, and obviously Roemon Fields with the steals. But a guy that's always in there and always seems to just be on base when we need to start putting some runs together is Tim Locastro. You know, a .398 on base percentage. He's one of those old school guys that, you know, he wears the high socks and isn't afraid to eat a pitch to get on base. He's already up to 12 hit by pitch on the season. And I think back to a game right at the end of our last homestand where we really needed the wins to keep pace with Spokane here in the North Division standings. And he got hit by a pitch 3 times in the game, scoring on 2 of them in a big comeback win for us there. And so he's just one of those guys that, you know, not only just with his offense and the defense, he's always turning, you know, tough double plays with his partner Barreto there. And a guy that just is so consistent but doesn't really get much recognition because he's not the star player any night, but he's always kind of a contributing factor to success here in Vancouver.
It's interesting to contrast him. He was playing with Barreto last year briefly, but Dawell Lugo was the shortstop paired up with him. And then this year, him and Franklin Barreto. And Barreto and Lugo are seen as really top-notch prospects. And there's Tim Locastro out of a small D3 school. And, as you said, an old-school sort of baseball player who helps the team win in so many different ways. That is an interesting and really a fun combination to watch.
Yeah, you see sort of that new-school baseball guys coming from, you know, South America and Dominican, and then just a guy that kind of reps that old school style. And to be honest, on a lot of those plays are around second base, he's really doing a lot of good work to help Barreto. You know, some of the tosses aren't always right at a perfect spot, but he just has this uncanny ability to just kind of lock in and have a real smooth turn to get the second runner at first. And it's been fun watching them play this season for sure.
The Vancouver Canadiens are at now 16-11, three games back of Spokane. I found a story on MILB.com written by Sam Dykstra about Roemon Fields, the leadoff man, and how he was signed to a professional contract when it didn't look like he would have a shot, and now what he's doing for the Canadiens, leading the league in stolen bases. What have you seen from Roemon Fields?
Well, he brings that swagger to the ballpark every single day, and you know the moment that he steps in the batter's box, he's not even just thinking about just getting on. He's planning on, once he gets on, he's getting over to third as quick as possible. We had a funny exchange where there was a reporter here wanting to talk to him about a little bit of his story, and I told him, I went to go grab him for the interview and told him that he wants to talk to you about obviously the speed and then potentially breaking the franchise record. And I think he was at 16 stolen base at the time. And he goes, he didn't even know. He goes, oh, what is the record, by the way? And I said, oh, it's 25. He goes, shoot, I'll be there next week, man. Like, he's one of those guys that just, wasn't a guy that really thought about a professional baseball career too much growing up, but came into it and has had a ton of success. And another kind of funny moment, he was in the room and talking about how, after the first few weeks in the season where he's racking up the steals, catchers and pitchers, know about him. They know his reputation. They know he's going, but even if they know he's going, they still can't seem to stop him. So it's been a real fun element to the Canadiens that we haven't had, for a lot of season, the speed, a lot of players bring on the base fast, but Fields especially is fun. Every time he gets on, the crowd's waiting for when he's going to make that move. And he's also induced a lot of a few balks as well in tight games where they're trying to hold him at one and they can't afford to put their runner in scoring position, and they end up doing it anyway because he's just so rattling as a presence over there at first base.
On the mound, looks like Miguel Castro is not getting rattled, regardless of who gets on against him. He's the reigning Northwest League Pitcher of the Week, back-to-back wins, an ERA of 0.9 in that span and striking out 13. He opened eyes right away by letting up the radar gun, and it seems as if even as he pitches onward, outing after outing, nobody in the Northwest League can figure out how to solve it.
Yeah, and we've got to remember, this guy's only 19 years old, and he's already showing kind of the poise of a veteran guy learning lineups. His last two starts, those two dominant starts you're talking about, they're against lineups that have seen him already this year. So, he's one of those guys that's, not just getting by on speed or a trick pitch. He's actually, learning hitters, and as the hitters adapt to him, he's learning how to pitch around them, as evidenced, like you said, by those 13 strikeouts versus only three walks. And there was a real mature moment I want to point out. The last start at home here against Salem Kaiser, second at bat of the game, he gives up a solo homer to their first rounder, Christian Arroyo, who is another name we'll probably hear about very soon in a few years. But it's really that moment where he had a rough start in Hillsboro, starts off with a home run there, and he could let that sort of eat him up, but then comes out in the second, K's the side, and then retires 12 of the next 15 batters, earning the win. So, it's one of those things you look for in a young talent with such a huge arm, but that maturity and that poise to be able to go with it.
The Vancouver Canadiens are currently about to begin a nice homestand, taking on Everett and then Eugene. Let's see, against the Everett Aqua Sox for three games, and then against Eugene, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, it's a five-game series. Both teams get to see the entire other team's starting rotation.
Yeah, those are always kind of fun to be able to see the whole pitching staff kind of match up one through one. And now that the calendar's turned to July and we've got through June, it's always kind of a scary month in Vancouver. We don't know how the rain's going to be, but the weather forecast looks great for all 8 days and three nooners on tap over the course of that span. So it's going to be some real good times here in Vancouver the next week and a half.
Mason Jar Water Bottle Giveaway Night tonight. Tomorrow night, the Fireworks Extravaganza. And then coming up Sunday, the Canadiens Replica Jersey Giveaway. So terrific weekend against Everett. Finally, our last question for Lucas with the Vancouver Canadiens, our question of the week, and that is, what is the most locked in you've ever seen a ball player?
Well, being my first season in Vancouver, I haven't had a lot to draw from here other than just Castro in the last little while, but a guy that I've always looked up to in the major leagues is a guy by the name of Cliff Lee, and he just always come postseason time. He's a guy that just always looks so locked in. I remember in 2009 where he just, constantly, every time they relied on him, he was just lights out on the mound. And I remember a specific at bat where there were runners on, and he squared up to bunt, but then turned it back and slapped a double to the gap. And it's just one of those guys that when he's dialed in, he can do it all. You know, you can put him in anywhere, put him at the plate, and he's still helping his team win. So that would probably be the most dialed in I've ever seen a player.
Lucas Scott with the Vancouver Canadiens. Lucas, thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks, Jesse, for having me. We'll talk again soon.
Absolutely. Till next Friday. From Lucas in Vancouver, now to Trey Wilson. And Trey and I are broadcast colleagues for the Lansing Lugnuts, single-A affiliate for the Toronto Blue Jays. Trey, we begin this week speaking about the Lansing Lugnuts, Matt Dean and Mitch Nay, both of them identical 12-game hitting streaks. It seems like the second half is treating them well.
I'm going to let you in on a little secret about Matt Dean. The dude can hit. Won the Appy League batting title last season, and this season he's consistently been up near the top of the league in hitting. Look at what he's done since the calendar turned in July. 9 games so far this month that we have seen, and sitting .275, 4 home runs in those 9 games with 11 runs driven in. And that's only been aided by what he did the last 3 nights over in Lake County up in Ohio. 7 hits in those 3 games, a couple of home runs, drove in 6 runs in those 3 nights. He's been consistently hitting all year, but he's taking it to a new level the last few weeks. And you mentioned Mitch Nay. He's hitting almost .400 since the month turned over to July, .395 for him, trying to creep back up to .300 after he had that slump earlier in the season. And he's been staying pretty consistently around .275, .280, but I don't think it'll be long before we see Mitch Nay climbing the leaderboard in the Midwest League.
One of those perpetual questions about Mitch Nay, and the two of us have heard it many times before, as he had posted on Bluebird Banter as one of the questions for us this week about Mitch and his power and his ability to drive the baseball. We had a discussion here last night, writes the commenter, about the total lack of extra base hits from Mitch Nay this year. Are you seeing things in at bats that could indicate that this could improve?
Well, yes, we've seen the power out of him, whether it be in batting practice or even over the last week where he's barely missed some long home runs that have hooked around the foul pole in left field. There were a couple of monster shots. One of them I'm still convinced was a fair ball, and I think Mitch is too. It was a tough call to make. It wrapped around a foul pole when we were on the road. Yeah, we both thought that it might have stayed fair, but it's there. He's definitely got it. I think that people are getting a little bit impatient wanting to see it. Well, here's some good news. We're in Bowling Green right now. Last time we were here, he hit a home run. He's got the power for it. He's doing what he has to do to help the team win, and that's driving runs and leading the team in RBIs, though. Yeah. Dean's starting to catch up with him. But he's been a great run producer. He's getting on base, and he's still so young. The power's going to be there. He's got the strength for it. He's got the bat speed for it, and it's just a matter of he just hasn't had it translate quite yet. I think it's going to be there. I don't think that anybody has a doubt of that. We've seen plenty of indications that he has a lot of power. He just hasn't pressed to hit home runs, and I think that that's been perfectly acceptable for somebody in this league that's not a very home run friendly league anyway.
Lugnuts are 10-10 right now in the second half. They've been up, and then they've dropped back down, winning streak followed by a losing streak. For the Lugnuts, is there any key? Is there something that could unlock a potential postseason second-half playoff run?
Well, getting the offense and the starting pitching on the same page would be helpful. The starting pitching has hit a bit of a tough skid of late. Hasn't really been anybody, aside from Jeremy Gabariski, who the Lansing Lugnuts have been able to rely on start after start and say, all right, we know this guy's going to go out and give us 5 to 7 innings, not allow more than 3 or 4 runs. And Jeremy Gabariski just got pinned with his first loss since back in April. And it was a game where 3 swings were the difference. A home run friendly ballpark on a very home run friendly day gave up 3 home runs. And the offense wasn't there to back it, ended up losing the game 4-3. And that's been the worst that we've seen Gabariski in a loss anyway. There was one start that he got knocked around a bit in that stretch, but he's been the most consistent factor in the rotation. I think if we could see some guys maybe Chase DeYoung turn a corner and become the pitcher that we've seen that he's going to be, a couple of things, little tweaks that he's working on, keeping the ball down, he's going to be just fine. I think when he can start getting the results to show it, that's going to go a long way in helping this team. And it's still a couple of other pieces in the rotation. Brad Allen has been good. He's still working back off the disabled list. Matt Dermody has been so good out of the bullpen after he had some struggles as a starter this year. He's had a nice turnaround since this month started, but the pitching's got to come around and help out the offense at some point. There has not really been a lack of offense in this month aside from games against Great Lakes, which for some reason Lansing can't hit. So as the pitching joins it, this should be a pretty good team.
A question of the week for Trey Wilson with the Lansing Lugnuts. What is the most locked in you've ever seen a baseball player?
Well, let's go with the second most locked in first, at least in the Blue Jays organization. I'll keep it in the Blue Jays organization. But last year, the last month plus, maybe 6 weeks of the Appalachian League season for Matt Dean was a pretty good turnaround. He ended up winning the batting title in that league and hit near 400 for the last 6 weeks of the season. But nothing compares to what we saw from Kevin Pillar back in 2011 when he was in Bluefield, his first pro season. Through the first part of the year, he hit 212 in June, and then he still wasn't even hitting. He didn't hit 300 for the month of July, but he turned a corner looking at the numbers. It was around July 21st. And on July 21st of that 2011 season, Kevin Pillar was hitting just 253. When the season ended on August 30th, he was hitting 347. He brought the average up nearly 100 points in about a five-week stretch. I mean, that was pretty impressive. For the month of August in 2011, Kevin Pillar hit 440. And it seemed like every night he was going out and having a two and a three hit night for five straight weeks. It was something that was the turnaround that he made after he had struggled so much in the first part of the year. And everybody's thinking, well, what are we going to do with this guy, 32nd round draft pick, maybe a roster filler. And he turned himself into a legitimate prospect and eventually rode that ability to hit in such good streaks all the way to the major leagues. And he's been in and out of it ever since. But that kind of tear, I haven't seen anybody else go on before.
Trey Wilson with the Lansing Lugnuts. And the Lugnuts are currently on the road. They'll be back home next Wednesday to start up a 6-game homestand at Cooley Law School Stadium. You can find Trey on Twitter at TreyWilson757. Trey, thank you.
Thanks, Jesse.
From Trey up the ladder, we move up to the A advanced level, the Florida State League, and the Dunedin Blue Jays. We're joined by Tyler Murray, the voice of the people. Tyler, how are things?
Jesse, I'm doing awesome. How are you, sir?
Doing very well. Thank you. We're in sunny Kentucky right now. Lugnuts in the Bowling Green. Hot Rod's about to get things going. Meanwhile, for your Dunedin Blue Jays, the initial question is, Taylor Cole is back. How's Taylor?
Oh, he's great. All is well. Went five innings yesterday, got the W, and Daryl Knowles told me before the game that they'd be very happy to get just five innings from them, and that's exactly what he provided. And the radar gun in Daytona, it's been a little bit malfunctional so far this season, but he was hitting 93 pretty consistently with a fastball, hit 94 a couple of times, and that's not really his strength. He's usually in the lower 90s with the heater, but it's always been that changeup this year anyway that helps him get those strikeouts, and he was able to rack up seven more in just five innings yesterday. Only trouble he ran into was bases loaded, nobody out in the third, and he got a double play and a strikeout, and the double play did score a run, but certainly a good job to limit the damage, and in the end, a well-deserved win, and we've been watching all year to see if he can stay within range of Joel Carreño's 173 strikeouts, a franchise record in Dunedin back in 2010, and with a good performance yesterday, he's right back on track, so that's great to see, and obviously great to have Cole back in the clubhouse, just for the reason that he's one of the better guys that we've had in a Dunedin uniform in quite some time.
Fun for me to watch the players who stepped up. After Daniel Norris gets promoted, suddenly there's Taylor Cole and Kendall Graveman ascending to the spot of saying, all right, we'll be your aces, especially with Matt Boyd getting promoted as well. Meanwhile, Dalton Pompey gets moved up to AA, and Dwight Smith Jr. checks in to make sure the people haven't forgotten him. Dwight Smith Jr. is mashing right now. Tell me about it.
Oh, it's amazing. And the big difference has been where he's batted in the lineup. When Dalton Pompey was here with Casey Hobson and company, it was Smith leading off with Pompey in the two slot, and then either Hobson or Connect batting third. But now, with the absence of those last two guys I just mentioned, Smitty is the three hitter, and he's been lights out. He had another triple yesterday, and he leads the league here in the Florida State League with 6 3 baggers now. He's played 10 games, all in July, batting third. And during those 10 games, Jesse, Dwight Smith is batting .447 with 5 doubles, a triple, a home run, and 9 runs batted in. He is filling a huge hole right in the key spot in the lineup. And since being put into the 3 spot at the beginning of this month, he's boosted his batting average from .269 up to .288. You really can't be any more happy with what Smith's been able to do. And Omar Mallovet looks like a genius for putting him in the 3 spot, and he really has been a big factor to the Blue Jays' success in the second half.
Looking over the DJ stats this month, they're 8-2. Pitching's been fine. The offense has been ridiculous. They've scored 59 runs in 10 games. It's one thing to bat .275. It's another to have the entire team drawing 47 walks. They're averaging nearly 5 walks a game. They must be the most frustrating team to pitch against.
And you got to give hitting coach Tubby Clapp a ton of credit. Marcus Kinect has been great plate discipline-wise lately. 7 walks in his last 7 games. Gustavo Pierre, a well-documented aggressive hitter, but he's drawn 8 walks this year, so double his total from last year already. And really the mentality for this lineup is, you know, without the big poppers like Hobson and Chung and Pompey, the guys that they were able to rely on in the first half to knock in those runs, there's not too much pressure put on anybody in general. It's just kind of let's get on base and let's knock each other in. They drew a bases-loaded walk yesterday and a win over the Daytona Cubs 7-4. And Stubby Clapp's mentality this year, he's telling all the players, just get on base and either score a run or not get a run. If you're part of one run per game, if all of us can contribute to one run per game, we're always going to be in a good spot to win. And that's why these guys aren't pressing too much. We saw maybe earlier in the year, say a guy like Emilio Guerrero gets ahead on a 3-1 count and don't swing at anything close, but now he's been doing a much better job holding off on some borderline pitches. He's got 14 walks this year now, which is a lot more than he was projected to have after the first couple of months in the season. And the patience really is paying off. And you said it, Jesse, they're getting good pitches to hit because of their patience. And so now one of the top 3 hitting teams in the league in batting average. So that's been a really pleasant surprise in the second half.
You brought up Emilio Guerrero, and that was a player I wanted to ask you about. Guerrero is currently riding a 10-game hitting streak. But defensively, we know about Craig Biggio going from second base to catcher to second base to center field, or Ben Zobrist playing right field or second base. Emilio Guerrero is trying to make the transition from shortstop to center field. How is that working out for him?
It's been a very exciting and unique experience just watching it happen. It started on July 1st. He's made 6 starts in center, and he's been mixed back into the shortstop position, 3 starts in the month of July there. So you have to imagine it's got to be tough for him to make an adjustment day after day. And early on, it seemed like he was so preoccupied with his defensive responsibilities that he wasn't necessarily as focused at the plate. But lately, he's come on strong, done a really nice job to put any feeling aside when he's batting and just take care of business there. And he hasn't been tested too much in center field so far, but you can finally see him show off the wheels. We know his figure. He's a tall, lanky guy with some good wiry strength to him. It's fun to see him head out to the alleys and gaps and track down some balls. He really does have good breakaway speed that you just don't see when you're at shortstop, but when you're out there in center field, he really can show off the wheels. So he has good gap-to-gap range, and as you might imagine, it's just a term of getting a good read off the bat to make sure you've got a good jump and take a good angle to it. Maybe that part's the only thing he needs to work on for now, but great speed and pretty solid instincts, good fundamentals. The arm has always been good from shortstop, and that'll translate well, I think, into center. But right now I'm going to say too soon to tell, Jesse, just because he hasn't been tested all that much. But so far, no errors. Maybe 1 or 2 misplayed balls, but no errors on the score sheet. So we're looking forward to seeing him continue out there in center, and I think he could stick.
Question of the week time. What is the most locked in you've ever seen a baseball player?
Well, to start this season, it had to be Matt Boyd on the mound. 31 innings, just 1 run allowed, and it was on a wind-assisted solo home run, and he certainly dominated the pitching or the hitting in the FSL to start this season. At the plate, I would say last year, Casey Hobson. About a year ago, maybe a little more than a year ago, on July 24th, he was struggling, but then he snapped out of it, against the Charlotte Stone Crabs in a four-game series on the road. He had 14 RBIs in four games with three homers mixed in, and there wasn't any ball that he was missing. Everything was hit hard, and it was a shocker when he was recorded out. So Hobson, a guy who we all know has strokes of genius every once in a while and will get it consistently going very soon, I'm sure, because when he's on, there's just no better hitter that we've seen down here in Dunedin. So got to go with Hobson at the plate and Boyd on the mound in terms of guys who've been locked in the last couple of years here.
Tyler Murray, thank you very much for joining us from Dunedin.
All right, Jesse, talk to you soon.
All right, till next Friday, enjoy yourself. From Tyler in the Florida State League, let's bring in Tom Gauthier, the voice of the New Hampshire Fisher Cats. Tom, have things settled down after last week and the crazy weather you were having?
Yeah, you know, things have settled down nicely. We had a rain out last week, and then we actually had on Tuesday, Monday of this week, we had a torrential downpour and actually didn't get the tarp on the field. It rained so badly. But since that rainstorm passed, we've had a little bit of rain late Tuesday night and Wednesday morning, had the field tarped at that point overnight, and we've been dry as a bone and beautiful out with very low humidity this week. So it's been a classic New England summer, which will likely be ending in the next couple of days because apparently record lows for July are coming up here in the next week or so.
Oh, boy. Well, enjoy yourself, huh?
Yeah, it's
weather during the baseball season.
Yeah, summer's too short here anyway. I don't know how people stand it up in the if you're north of the Mason-Dixon line weather-wise. Bowling Green was one thing when I was down there for 3 years, and it was nice because it started to warm up in February and March, but a long winter and a very bad spring, and now all of a sudden summer starting to become mediocre as well. So really makes you want to live in New England with high tax rates, high property taxes, expensive rents. All of that stuff just adds up to make it a glamorous place to live.
I'm talking to you currently from right next to where you used to call home. I am calling you from Bowling Green Ballpark.
And it's probably about 95 degrees there. It's probably a little bit breezy. You're probably going to have a thunderstorm in the next hour or so. I mean, it's the classic Kentucky day. It's not any better there, but I'm sure that's what's on the agenda for the afternoon.
You know what? You said it. That is exactly what they're calling for. They're saying 97 tomorrow.
Yep,
let's talk
about
Casey
right.
Lawrence. Casey Lawrence, one batter away from a perfect game. My gosh. He throws 84, he throws 85, he moves it all over the place, he commands like nobody else, out of Pennsylvania. Tell me about Casey.
You know, Casey's, first of all, he's a great guy. You know, he knows who he is as well as anybody, and I think when you have pitchers like that that really know who they are and what they do, and at the double-A level, you tend to get a lot of that. Guys that have been around a while, they know exactly what they are. They're not what they were in high school when they threw 95, or they're not what they were when they first came into the game. They're not a hot shot prospect anymore, but they know who they are, which I think gives them the ability to learn how to pitch and to really know how to pitch. And Casey's the epitome of that. He'll touch 90 occasionally, but he's in that 87 to 89 range, has a good breaking ball, throws a changeup, and as you mentioned, the number one important thing for him is keeping the ball down and then locating it inside and outside, and that's what he's done here now for quite a while. He's on his best run here in Double-A now that he's getting a full season in Double-A. The last couple of years he had cups of coffee, and that was really about it. And at that point, you know, it's a crapshoot as to what's going to happen because one start can really skew your numbers at that point. But he's come off the DL. He's not skipped the beat. He hasn't allowed an earned run in his last 32 and a third innings for more than the last – it's almost 2 months now. By the time he starts on Monday, it'll be almost 2 months since he's allowed an earned run, and it will be against the team that we're playing this weekend, the Portland Sea Dogs. Just fun to watch. He works quick. He's one of those guys that you can tell what you're probably going to get right away with him, but you know that even on a tough day, he's still probably going to get you six innings.
It was Casey Lawrence in his last outing teamed up with a Fisher Cat batter to help the New Hampshire Fisher Cats destroy the poor Rock Cats of New Britain. Dalton Pompey has had a lot of focus paid to him, especially rising up prospect rankings. He had a harsh welcome to the AA level. What are you seeing from Pompey in recent days?
I think you're seeing a guy that's just getting his footing. I mean, he had a great season in the Florida State League, and I think even at the end of the FSL campaign that he had, he wasn't hitting bullets anymore. He wasn't putting up a 400 average at all. He kind of came back down to earth a little bit. He came up here to Double-A, and he's a young guy. I mean, Pompey was drafted out of high school from Canada. He is, 21 years old right now, so he's still very young. He doesn't turn 22 until December. So you're seeing a young guy that came up to a new level, switch hitter, facing pitchers that have six, 7 years on him age-wise, and maybe even more than that experience-wise, and you expect that guy to struggle, and all of a sudden he's starting to figure it out now. He's starting to make better contact. Had a nice that ended up being the difference in the game on Sunday with Casey Lawrence, or whatever day it was, with Casey Lawrence on the hill Wednesday afternoon. So it's just a guy that's starting to find his own and starting to come into his own. When you look at him, he's had 48 at-bats, so it's still very, very early in his Double-A career.
The mix of the talent at the Double-A level fascinates me, with the guys coming up, the guys who've excelled, the veterans who've bounced around a bit. Looking at your three all-stars, you've got the flame-throwing Dustin Andelin in the bullpen. There's Randy Boone, age 30, who pitched for the Lugnuts back in 2008. And there's scrappy John Birdie, who plays wherever you need him, but provides outstanding defense, steals bases, causes some havoc. Tell me about your view on these three Fisher Cats all-stars. Did you think any more guys would make it? Did anybody surprise you?
I think Casey Lawrence not making it is kind of bogus, because the way that it works, and I'm sure it's the same way in other leagues, they don't choose the all-star team and then make substitutions after that. They choose the all-star team primarily on guys that are available to play or available to pitch. So Casey Lawrence is going to pitch on Monday. He's not available to pitch in the all-star game on Wednesday, so he's not going to be named an all-star. And I think really that's a shame, because he had been our most consistent guy from day one through his injury at the end of May and then through his restart here in the towards the end of June through where we are right now. So him aside, I really don't think we had any snubs. Mike McDade is making a good push at the end, but missed the first month of the season. He wasn't here and then started out slowly. So the three guys that made it, I think, are justly deserved to make it. I think they deserve to be there. John Birdie's been an everyday guy for us. Numbers may not blow you away. He may not hit 300. He doesn't have 9 or 10 home runs. Has a lot of stolen bases. He's getting better defensively. He's aggressive when he's out there, and he plays hard every single day, and he's played just about every single day, although as I say that, he does have his second off day in the last 8 games tonight, but he's an everyday guy. Randy Boone has just been a stalwart out of that bullpen. He's been a leader out of that bullpen. When we were really struggling there in the middle of May, he's the one that went to Bobby Meacham and our pitching coach Jim Sikowski and said, you know what, guys, I've closed before. Give me a shot. Let me try to take it. And then he converted 9 saves on about 40 total pitches. It was outstanding and remarkable what he did. When he was getting a save, there were 9 in a row that he converted, or 8 in a row that he converted. And then Dustin Andelin, maybe the best story of the bunch, because when he was at Double-A last year, struggled a little bit coming up, and then he got into a bit of a groove where he was doing okay, and then the wheels completely fell off the wagon in the month of August. I think he allowed something like 20 runs in his last 8 or 10 innings. I mean, it was something outrageously bad, and now he's come back and he's posted an ERA right around 3, and it was actually below 3 until this last weekend when he gave up a couple of runs in his last outing, coincidentally on the day they named the All-Star team. So those three guys are All-Stars. I think that it's probably fitting that they're the stars, considering that they've been here for the majority of the season and they're still here right now.
Joined by Tom Gauthier, the voice of the New Hampshire Fisher Cats. There was a game earlier this week, I believe. Daniel Norris was on the mound. However many scouts, maybe dozens of scouts, were in attendance, and he didn't last the first inning. Tell me this from your perspective.
It was a rusty guy that hadn't pitched in 9 days, Jesse, and I think we talked to him the day after, and he said the same thing. And I said, it's funny because, you know, we haven't talked to you yet. Now we're going to talk to you after you face 7 batters and, you know, a couple to get on and score, and you don't make it out of the first inning. And he wasn't shaken up, obviously, about it. They lined him up so he could pitch in the Futures game on Sunday, so they gave him a couple of extra days rest, and he just came out rusty. Didn't have it in the bullpen, he said. Did not have it, obviously, when the game started. And I think at one point gave up a home run and then really tried to overthrow. You can see the next couple of pitches put a lot of extra effort into it. And when that happens, we all know what's going to happen. The fastball is going to go everywhere. You're not going to have any command. And that's exactly what happened on Wednesday or Thursday, whatever day he started. That's what happened. And, you know, you take it for what it is. It's a bad start by a young pitcher after a lot of rest. But he'll get the start, or he'll pitch on Sunday in the Futures game and then come back on probably 5 or 6 days rest and pitch again for us next week and probably strike out 7 guys in 6 innings.
it sounds pretty darn good to me. I even was reading something about speculation that Danny Norris would be bumped up to AAA, and this all seems to me like a whirlwind tour for both him and Dalton Pompey, but it has to be fun for you in New Hampshire being right in the crux of things.
You know, it is nice, and the team's playing a lot better, and then you get young guys that come up and you help them out. So it's been a lot of fun. You know, our run differential, I just looked it up today since we started this 38-game streak. We're 25-13 in it, and we've been outscoring opponents by a combined 49 runs. So it's a pretty simple formula, but it's been a fun formula to watch, and it's been a fun group to be around because they were good when we were losing. They're even better right now when we're actually winning games.
How is Matt Boyd looking in his second time going around with New Hampshire this year?
I did not see him yesterday. I had yesterday's game off at home to get ready for the road trip today. But when he came back and made his first start with us on Monday, he looked phenomenal. He looked like he was a totally different pitcher. He came out there, he was throwing strikes Saturday night. Came out, he was aggressive with the fastball, threw a lot of fastballs, and just looked like a guy that was working with a little more pace. Probably looked like the guy that Dunedin fans got used to when they saw him down in the Florida State League. He was aggressive, he was attacking, and really the Trenton Thunder had no chance against him that night. Finished with 9 strikeouts, fourth or fifth time he's done that this season across all levels. Fun guy to watch that night, looked like a totally different pitcher, did not look shell-shocked, knew like he knew what to expect, and I think that was a big thing because he admitted it when he first came up here, very nervous the first 2 starts, and I think it just sort of steamrolled on him from there, and he never really got it under control.
This is Tom Gauthier, the voice of the New Hampshire Fisher Cats. Our question of the week this week was simply players who have been locked in, inspired by how well Clayton Kershaw had been, even with his scoreless streak ending yesterday. Who are the most locked-in players you've seen?
I think Casey Lawrence right now, the streak that he's in, has been pretty impressive. Marcus Stroman had a good streak for us last year, and I think it was really pretty much the end of July through the end of August, through the end of the season. Had a couple of 13 strikeout games in there. But the one guy that stands out to me when I first saw this, we had a player by the name of Derek Dietrich who was up with the Marlins. I don't know if he's with them at this moment right now, but he's been back and forth with them to AAA in Florida or Miami this season. A kid by the name of Derek Dietrich, you saw him down there in Bowling Green,
yeah.
Jesse. And he had a stretch with us in the second half of the season where he really carried us offensively and was really our best player all year that year, a guy that started out a little slow and had all the hype and the prospect hype and then all of a sudden just turned on and ended up being our home run leader. And I remember at one point our staff was like, all right, let's take wagers on who's going to be our home run leader at the end of the season. And that was the guy that I picked because you figured at some point he was going to start to connect. And at one point during that year in July, homered in 5 straight games. I've never seen that on any level of baseball. And it was fun to watch because he was hitting opposite field home runs. The ballpark you're in tonight, Jesse, he put one into that grass berm as a left-handed hitter in left center field. And that's not a short porch by any means for a lefty.
No, I'm looking at it right now. It's quite a trip. If you hit it down the corner, sure. But no, going opposite field to the left center lawn, that's a shot. There's
on
a question
line
sent in from a comment. Oh, man. Well, a question sent in from a commenter on Bluebird Banter, wondering about Gregory Infante, who apparently was described as a one-trick pony by Ben Bradley of Baseball America, that one trick being a 100-mile-an-hour fastball. You've seen Gregory Infante more than anybody else. What are your thoughts about him?
You know, it's funny because Ben Badler was here with us this last weekend, and he saw Infante pitch this week when he pitched a scoreless inning a couple of nights ago. One-trick pony because that's literally all he did that night. It was a 5-4 loss. He only threw fastballs in the 20 or so pitches that he delivered, and he hit 100 a couple of times during that. He does have a good slider. He's a guy that has some major league experience, went up to the big leagues a few years ago and was up there for a little bit here and there, never had any extensive experience, but he's a guy that throws 100 miles an hour. He knows how to pitch again, has pretty good command, doesn't walk anybody, and at this level, when you're throwing 100 miles an hour out of the bullpen, we saw it with a guy with Redding earlier this season. He was throwing 100, and I think he gave up 10 hits in like 20 innings. He went his first 5 or 6 innings without giving up a hit at all. When you do that, you're going to throw, and you throw strikes, you're going to have good numbers, and that's what Infante has. And probably would have been an all-star here, but I know that he's going to be heading down to Miami to see his family because with the travel to Buffalo this year, he has not had a chance to get home. So he's got to get home to spend some family time with his family this year. And he's been impressive, and he's a guy that I'd be surprised if he's here all season the rest of the year. And I wouldn't be surprised to see him in the major leagues at some point because he throws that hard and he's got that good of stuff.
The Fisher Cats close out a road trip at Portland on Monday. Then they break the All-Star game on Wednesday. And then they're back home next Thursday all the way through the Wednesday, July 23rd. Tom Gauthier, thank you very much for joining us on Around the Nest.
Sounds good, guys. We'll talk to you next week.
Till next Friday. Well, we were joined this week by Tom Goff here in New Hampshire, also by Tyler Murray in Dunedin, Trey Wilson in Lansing, Lucas Scott in Vancouver, Chris King of Baseball Prospectus, and Kevin Fitzgerald of Bluefield. I'm Jesse Goldberg-Strassler. Remember, check YouTube, check SoundCloud. Until next Friday, this has been Around the Nest.